Ladies and gentlemen, by the way, don't we have the best band in the world? Give them a hand. Ladies and gentlemen, I do have a small favor to ask. We have some more people coming in. There are some places in the front here. We have this guy here. He's the official photographer of Dimexco. And we need a very great picture with good-looking people, smiling, behaving nice. So I need your help. That would be awesome. This guy is taking the picture, and I need you to help me. I think you have all seen some... Have you ever seen how people who are deaf applaud? They do it like this. So I would like to, all of you, you need that picture to raise both of your hands and shake him. Please do that for me. Come on. I want to see your hands. And now we have to take the picture. Take the other photograph. Come on, I want to see you, I want to hear you. You need that picture, what it makes you. Come on now, do it again. Come on, I want to see your hands. I want to see all your hands. Yes, that's what we want to have. All right. Thank you very much. That will be on the website of Dimexco, that picture. Coming to our next topic, ladies and gentlemen. Sorry for the people outside, the place is packed. We have actually 300 people waiting outside, so you're lucky to be in. And actually it pays off because the next panel will be awesome, will be great. Great minds talking great stuff. Ladies and gentlemen, we would like to talk about video advertising. We would like to talk about video. Video is everywhere. For the mobile first generation, people can learn a lot of things in a very quick time. On video, and we would like to talk all about video right now. And ladies and gentlemen, are you right? Is anybody here would like to listen to something about video ads? Good, good, thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome, and please give him a big hand, please welcome Irina Petricek-Steiner. She's General Manager Operations of EMEA of SpotX. But there's more to come, ladies and gentlemen. Please welcome Norm Johnston, CEO of Unruly. Woo!
Dude.
But we do have more, ladies and gentlemen. Please welcome Jannika, Bock, Director, Client Solutions Central Europe from Google. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Patrick Fischer, CBO of OneFootball. Woo! Ladies and gentlemen, there is more to come, please. He goes by the name Jim Piercy, is Group Creative Director of The Trust and some more of the... And ladies and gentlemen, now I need you to welcome. He's one of the true rock stars, ladies and gentlemen. He is a very great mind. Some might know him as the serial marketer. Please welcome David Berkowitz, the host of the panel. It's all yours.
Well, that is some intro. Guten Tag. Sprech dir English. Yeah, okay. I've been working on a bit of Duolingo before coming here. So ich komme aus New York. Der Bär ist Fisch. They have a lot of phrases that don't really matter for a conference like this. So I'm going to stick to English and dive into video advertising. Video is an amazing space. Even as I was just coming in here, I'm like, my sunglasses are recording video right now. I mean, it's like anywhere, everywhere. For anyone have these Snapchat spectacles? It's fascinating. And so so we've got an incredible group of experts here, have a lot of questions, excited to dive in. And I'm David Berkowitz, founder of the Serial Marketers Community. And so let's start things off with the panel sharing a little bit about why they're here today. And Irina, we'll start with you and then just get this thing moving.
Sure. Thanks, David. My name is Irina Petricek-Steiner. That's the complicated name at the beginning. And I think the biggest challenge we currently have in our industry is to shape the video market and its future. And with converging traditional broadcast and online video, I think advertisers want to see cross-screen solutions where they can target consumers across all touch points. And I work for a company called SmartClip, SpotX. That's an ad tech company with monetization part of RDL. And of course, we focus a lot on building the bridge between traditional broadcast and online video.
Norm Johnston with Unruly, also apparently a Pop Idol finalist. I don't know what's going on with the band, but that was great. I loved it. You could take them everywhere with me. And we are a global programmatic platform for video with a great office here in Germany that we're very proud of. And we are fighting to make advertising better, which is why we're part of the Global Alliance for Responsible Media, amongst other things. And we are fighting to bring creativity and emotion into the world of programmatic, which it desperately needs, which we'll get into a little bit later.
Sure.
Who of you has watched a video on YouTube in the past 30 days? Give me a show of hands, please. According to GfK, 45 million in German for 18 years and older have been on YouTube in the past 30 days, every single month. My name is Jannika Bock, and I'm responsible at Google to help local agencies and advertisers to reach their business objectives with video ads on YouTube and beyond. And I'm really, really excited about the recent product innovation that we've seen on YouTube and video in general, because it enables advertisers to be successful along the entire marketing funnel, from generating awareness to driving actions.
My name is Patrick. I just realized that it's my 20th de Mexico. I started my career in 1999 at OMD in Düsseldorf. The older of you already know. So I'm the chief business officer of OneFootball, and our biggest vision is at OneFootball to bring the football content to the user back again, and to just remind ourselves, as I think everybody in the business should do that, that the product is built not for the business, it's built for the clients, for the customer. So customer centricity is basically the vision of our company. That's why we just recently launched our pay-per-view model for second Bundesliga and DFB, so German Cup in Germany, in Italy and UK. So user centricity is the biggest issue for our business at these times.
Well, thank you. And this room and certainly this panel is really not helping my imposter syndrome. But I am Jim Piercy. I am the Group Creative Director at The Trust, which is our intelligence-led creative consultancy at the Wall Street Journal Barron's Group. And I guess I'm sat up here because a large proportion of my life is spent ideating, creating, producing, advertising video creative for our clients and our partners.
And so I want to dive in, and really one of the first things I want to bring up is actually something we were just really organically talking about, because it's such a fascinating topic, and that's personalization. And right now it's possible that to deliver ads that are personalized to every single person in this room and millions and millions of versions if you wanted. It's also possible to just deliver that one ideal experience that connects us all too, and that all of us have seen. And so I'd love to know your takes right now on how far you think it's important to push personalization, and how much does it matter right now? So Jim,
I can start if you like. I might come at this from a slightly different angle, because I think personalization, customization, optimization are all incredible tools, and they're really useful. And I think they, you know, as Norm says, they actually help inform us at the start of a process, and they help make advertising better. But what they don't do is make bad creative good creative. And I think we always have to be mindful of that, that the kind of vast suite of new tools that are available to us as creatives and marketers, that they don't take precedent over ideas that resonate with an audience. Mm-hmm.
I would say that, you know, the before I was at Unruly, I was at Mindshare on the agency side, so we worked quite closely with big advertisers. And I think that the biggest complaint that consistently came through with all of them was the frustration with creative agencies that they didn't get data and they didn't know how to use it to tell stories. So they would revert back to, and I'm generalizing because they're different agencies that do different things, but in general, that was the biggest complaint that I would hear on a consistent basis. So I think that whole power of personalization is missing in many cases because of that void. It's quite interesting because, you know, I was part of WPP, and you listen to Martin Sorrell now, and of course he's got Mighty Hive, and he's got these companies that do that sort of thing. So obviously he was hearing the same thing I was hearing. He's gone off to do something about it. And of course there are creative agencies that have done a very good job in that particular space. But that was the vacuum. Now the question then becomes, once you have the tools to do it, and I would say that, you know, the technology is getting better and that's it's becoming more cost efficient, at what level of personalization do you stop? Because you can take it to an extreme. And some of the conversations that I would have with the DTC brands that are very dependent on a level of personalization is that there are diminishing returns. So you have to look at the category, the story that you're trying to tell, the objectives of the campaign, and determine where is that fine line where once you cross it, it's just no longer impactful, you've lost the story, et cetera. Mm-hmm.
I think that's really interesting because consumption attitude kicks in, right? When you take the big screen, consumers want to get entertained and lean back. That's the attitude, how they consume video on the big screen. And then you have much less attention on short form video on mobile, right? And I think the important thing is that you provide advertisers a solution cross-device where storytelling is possible and take into account the different consumption attitude. That's really key.
Mm-hmm. I want to go deeper a little bit on two of the points that you just touched upon, Irina. One of them is that if you have different devices, people are in different circumstances and they require different creatives. I mean, if you're on your mobile, you're watching a video, you're on the go, you may not have a lot of time and you don't want to spend a lot of time watching an ad. And that's why we've seen the rise of shorter creatives. Take bumper ads on YouTube, for example. They only see 6 seconds. Or we've seen other creative formats that leverage the entire screen, also in a vertical format. So I think this is really important. So different devices, different circumstances, different creatives in order to be effective. But and the other thing, the other thing that you touched upon was storytelling. And I think that's also really important because if we look at what drives impact, I think sequencing is something that's really, really important. If we link creative assets and show them subsequently to a user, to someone, we can tell a story. And we've seen in numerous studies with Ipsos, for instance, that they have a greater impact on all kinds of metrics, from brand awareness to ad recall to purchase intent, and quite significantly, sometimes twice as much of an impact than a regular ad.
But, sorry. Go ahead.
No, you go ahead.
but even because you mentioned short form more on mobile devices, we have clients experiencing short form or testing short form on linear broadcast, right? That's, I think, really interesting because there you see how the two worlds converge even closer now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so from the data that we've got our EQ data, which is millions of data points and millions of videos that we've reviewed over the years, and what's not contradicting anything you're saying, but what's interesting is the short form video, the 6 seconds, is very good at certain things. If you're trying to get brand awareness or brand favorability, good luck with that. It's not very good at doing it. It's very good for performance, immediate action, and there's different sorts of emotions that you can use within a 6 second ad to get that particular action. If you're looking for awareness, you're going to have to do something a little bit longer. It's going to take a little bit more in-depth time. Now, if you're looking for favorability, you need something like a Nike, you know, that's really going to change the perception of the brand, something much more in-depth, a longer form video that's out there. So I also think beyond just the device and the location, you really got to think about what you're trying to achieve, and then within those confines, what are the best emotions to evoke to really get someone to respond based on the objectives that you've got?
And that's a good point, because you don't if you use a short set format, like a bumper ad, for instance, you're absolutely right. There are only certain things that you can convey in a six-second format.
Yeah.
And I think that's why the idea of sequencing is also so powerful, because you can continue telling a story over several instances and pick up on it. But what you mentioned, Norm, is that, first of all, it needs to be very clear, what is your objective? What are you trying to achieve as a brand with the video ad that you're running? And then really look into, use the, I mean, I think you mentioned that at the very beginning, Jim, use the tools that you have available and to understand how are people reacting with the creators, what are they appreciating about it? And then once you understand, you can expand by really first understanding means looking at data points, doing a couple of tests, testing different creatives to different audiences, for instance. And once you've figured out what works in order to get to the message or get the message across that you want to get across, you can expand on that.
So, well, I do want to dive into this because, Norm, you mentioned something that at least for me, and I wonder about the people in this room here, seemed counterintuitive. And so the idea that often for, you know, 6 seconds or sometimes if you're watching something as you're scrolling through Facebook or Snapchat or just, you know, trying to get your job done, often you might only see the logo and something and don't even have time to process it, might not even have the sound on in the first place. And one might think that to get an action done, you need to be able to tell the entire story to go and then, you know, convince someone to go click a link, you know, buy now, sign up for a lead if it's, you know, share your info for especially for something more B2B oriented. And I'm curious for others here, how much you're seeing, you know, length apply to goal and if it's used in a certain way. I mean, even with Patrick, how you're using certain kinds of
video.
You know,
I just want to add something. I don't like the word personalization because it comes from a tech perspective. I really want to put into the center of our thinking the relevance. At the end, our goal is relevance, and the relevance starts with the content for the user. It follows with the creativity and even if with the media plan. You know, there are different purposes on TV ads or bumper ads on YouTube. It has to be the right ad in front of the user. It has to be relevant. That's the major thing. And my guess is in the last couple of years with the race of tech into our business, the relevance was not yet in the focus. It's just, you know, we could do this and that, and at the end, it's not relevant to the user. And we are 300 people in this room. I expect that a lot of people see not relevant ads at the moment if you look at every entity. So a lot of tech things, if I look at the OTT platform here in Germany, it's possible that I see like 10 Coca-Cola ads in a row. It's possible in this year. So for us, it's super important to put relevance in the center of the thinking, and it has to be the major goal for all, for creativity, for tech, for delivery and media planning. So I think that's the biggest issue.
For the kinds of video ads that you run and you're dealing with, does it skew more toward, you know, brand or
at the moment,
or in a goal?
At OneFootball, we are definitely looking for brand content, but it's not in front of the user, it's irrelevant what we would like to do or like to have. Of course, we would like the 20-second maximum CPM campaigns running and the best blue chip brands in the world, but the reality is different. You know, you have to look at it. If the user is consuming content while commuting, he's not able to receive a 20-second message in our app. So, of course, we are running bumper ads as well. We changed ads between daytime and nighttime. We try to accept, you know, the usage of the app and the message. And it's it begins with media planning. So is media planning ahead of creativity, where you develop a core creative idea, or is the creative idea in the center, or starts the journey with that, and media planning comes after it? For me personally, it should start with media planning, because every media outlet has its own a right, so to say, an impact on the user.
100% agreed on the user experience, Patrick, but of course I think it's important to focus on the KPIs an advertiser wants to achieve. I guess to your point, David, before, if you really go for storytelling and use cross-device solutions, I think it's easily to play whether with video, paying off more for branding, or more activation ads like performance ones, for example. And I think if you really tell that story and take the consumer at the touch point where he is, you can quite easily play with different KPIs and targets.
I think we do have to be, as an industry, actually much more discerning about these type of metrics. The question is that what length works. And of course, we have kind of best practice, and we have our internal research and our insight that gives us our kind of sweet spot. But it goes back to what everyone on the panel has said, actually, that when we start dealing with this data, we're looking at averages, and we're not looking at individual campaigns, and we're not judging what that particular message is. Now, 6-second video in one sector to a certain demographic can run a completely different piece of creative for two competing clients and both be successful. If you look at that just from a data perspective, you say, well, that's probably the right way to go. So I think we just have to be really careful and constantly interrogate what it is we're doing over and above the number.
So what's also interesting is having this mix of perspectives on creative, on tech, on behavior, but also on media. And Patrick, you talk about the issue of relevance, and what I'm curious for the whole panel, and then Jim, you mentioned some of how good tech and tools like personalization can't fix bad creative, but can better media planning at least fix a lot of the relevance part?
Well, I'll jump in because I was in the media agency business for a while. Yes, I think it can. I've been in digital since 95 now, so I've sort of seen all these swings of different ways that we go, and there was a period of time where buying an audience was just what you had to do. It didn't matter where it was, and I think there's been now a swing of the pendulum back to context. Like, context does matter. Mm-hmm. Where you see a video is going to make a huge difference in terms of the way that you engage with it, the perception, and we've got that data. Then when you're looking at video and premium publishing environments, mm-hmm. you're much more willing to buy, it's much more trustful, et cetera. Hopefully we'll get a bit of, but I say on the KPI thing too, likewise on the media front, I've had a couple discussions over the last months with advertisers around their agencies being too myopic on viewability and all these other, which ends up becoming the outcome. And I'm like, that's not the outcome.
Right.
The outcome is about what you're trying to achieve from a branding perspective or performance. It isn't just about 100% view, yeah. blah, blah, blah. And unfortunately, within some of these trading desks, you have people that slavishly just go after that. That's all that really counts. So I think that's another area where I feel the pendulum's now starting to swing a little bit back. If it's not just about that, it's a much more strategic view of what you're doing. And it's not a binary thing of in-stream and out-stream and other formats. It's how do those things work together in different ways across the journey with different people?
Yeah, I think couldn't agree more. When you come in from the perspective of an advertiser, right, reach is obviously important, but then a brand safe environment and the content makes a difference here, right? So I think if you look at traditional broadcast TV, you have all of that. You have still emotionally driven spots, then there is still incredible reach, and then of course there is a brand safe environment, and their ATV kicks in, right? If you extend all those benefits and advantages from linear TV and add their all targeting capabilities you have certainly available for digital targeting, then I think that makes really a difference.
I feel for you. I've got good friends at Google. I really do, because I saw all the data and I lived through all the brand safety stuff firsthand. And it's not, we've always had brand safety issues in the industry. I mean, dating all, it's a bit like doping at the Olympics. You just have to constantly run it. But you've got a bigger challenge than we do, arguably, because of the nature of the beast of what you've got. It's immensely popular. You've got millions and millions of people that are on it. And endemically, it's got all this content that just gets uploaded. So you've got a challenge, but it's not, it won't go away. And I think the same thing with Facebook. If people have to recognize it's going to be an ongoing issue, just as you have with the Olympics or the Tour de France, that there's always someone that's going to figure out a way of circumventing the system. And I think as advertisers, they have to kind of get their head around that. Either they're comfortable with certain protocols or they're not. And I'd say the other thing that you've gone through on YouTube is, you know, I remember quite well because, you know, digital spend suddenly becomes quite high. And for the first time, you have a CMO and a board level member looking at where their advertising is next to. And they looked at the YouTube video and they're like, what in the world is this stuff? Now, part of that is what you consider premium is different for youngsters, for young kids, or for millennials. I mean, they consider that premium as well. It's just a new definition of premium. But there's also a lot of other stuff on there that's quite a challenge for you.
But you call it a challenge, I would call it a responsibility. Mm-hmm. If you have an open platform, and I mean, YouTube is an open platform, it does come with responsibility on how you're going to ensure that the content that is available on YouTube is appropriate. And I don't know how closely everyone in this room has been following this, but we've been updating and continuously been working not only on your community guidelines, meaning how do people interact on YouTube in terms of like the comments that they're leaving, the videos that they're uploading, and so forth, but also the policies to the what extent is a video going to be monetizable. And I think this is a fundamentally important thing. Monetization is not a right on YouTube. Yeah? We consider it a privilege, and we want to reward those kind of content that is applicable and meets our high community guidelines to be open for monetization and be open to show ads against it. There are lots of other things that are being done in the realm of brand safety or ensuring brand safety. But what I would like to also come back to you is that you mentioned what is the content in which an ad shows up. Mm-hmm. And I think it's important that if an advertiser is really, really not only concerned, but it's really important to the advertiser, the kind of content that they're shown against, I think there are solutions for that. For YouTube, for instance, we offer something called Google Preferred, which is curated content, handpicked, you're 100% brand safe. If, however, you want to explore, and I think you mentioned that earlier, Patrick and Jim, you want to explore in terms of what kind of audiences do I want to reach, and where can I reach this audience best? It might be a different advertising strategy. That's why it's always so important, in my opinion, to start with what's the advertising goal that you have in mind, so that the advertiser can build not only the creative, but the media plan and the measurement setup in order to track, am I actually getting to what I wanted to get, the impact that I wanted to drive with my campaign. And something that we have not really talked about a lot when we discussed personalization is the user, right? I mean, a user wants to get ads that are relevant if they want to get ads at all. Yeah? Mm. So they need to be relevant, and they want to be informed and in control of the kind of advertising that they're able to see. And I think this is really important, that not only on YouTube, but on whatever platform, that you're able to see what is the data that is being used or the data points that are being used in order to serve your personalized ads, and that you have a choice to say, I don't want this kind of advertising, or actually, I would like to get advertising on this specific topic area because that's what I'm interested in.
So, and this is great that we're dealing with some of these really important media issues like brand safety and also bringing up creative and relevance when it comes to video. I want to get a little more tactical for a minute. And this might apply to anyone in the room who's working with video advertising right now. When you talk about outcomes, then what are the most important outcomes? Because like, you know, you've got that bar where there has to be that trust and brand safety for someone to even, you know, spend the first dollar and definitely the next one in the first place. But what are your buyers really looking for from you, and what's gonna make them determine what success looks like, and if they, you know, if they keep investing with you? So what are the specific outcomes that matter?
Well, I think. Yeah, and this applies to everyone here, that if somebody's advertising to have a business and a business needs to make money, I mean, it sounds it's obvious, right? But and we talk about this in content. You know, we're lucky at the journal. We talk about context. You know, we're the most trusted news source in America. So that there's some parameters around working with us already. What does success look like? That's different for everyone. Like, ultimately, these companies have to add to their bottom line. And if the video work and the advertising isn't contributing to that, it's not successful.
But how are your clients determining that?
So that's, and actually I think this is something that we've certainly got better at, but there is still room to improve as an industry actually, is to interrogate briefs, interrogate outcomes and KPIs a lot better. Mm-hmm. You know, I get in trouble because I'll often say, look, this isn't even a brief. Why are they doing this? They should just do some display advertising. That would do this job. But to ask, so, oh, we want to do some content. Why do you want to do content? Oh, I don't know, just everyone's doing content. Mm-hmm. So actually, let's work out what it is that you're trying to do, and then we can do that together. We have the research, we have the insight, we have the tools, but what's the business outcome that you want? Mm-hmm. I don't think that's asked enough.
For most of the advertisers, I don't think they're quite clear on what they want. I mean, I think there's not a lot of debate around the outcome. Some are more short-term focused, some are more long-term focused. I think what they're looking for is what's going to make a real difference to that outcome. We have a deluge of data. There's a data swamp out there that's been big data. You know, I wrote a book about it a couple of years ago. You can buy it for 25 cents on Amazon. But yeah, there's so much data out there that I think they're now kind of digging into that of what is really going to make a difference. And yeah, the one thing that we dwell on is emotion. And when you think about relevance, we've got sophisticated algorithms and machine intelligence. We've got lots of cool. We don't have a lot of emotional differentiation. And trying to get to that, we think, makes a huge, both short-term and long-term. You look at short-term, if you have something that has a greater emotional impact, your sales go up by 23%. Long-term brand building, if it's something with more of an emotional impact, your long-term business outcomes come up by 43%. Long-term business, you know, market share, price elasticity, margin, those sorts of things. So for us, it's a deeper discussion around how do we make a real difference on the outcomes that you've laid out already.
You really have to look at the impact of your business. Are you optimizing on the short term? Are you looking on a monthly revenue base, or do you look on the lifetime value of each user for the next 24 months? So, and your monetization strategy should follow. So it would be an easy one to go open market for video ads, like display 30-second spots, but I would lose my user base within the next six months. So it's not a long-form strategy. But there you have to decide whether you are a corporate business where you have to show growth. You automatically start to monetize every single spot you have to show growth, or you are an early stage startup business where you can really build your decent user base and have the chance to build the right monetization model to it. So with relevance, with the right media products, I think you are able to scale there as well. You know, but you know, as you said, to have the right context and the right content on the platform. We are a platform as well, but we are a closed platform. It's going to be a tough challenge to have the right context as well. So,
I think it's never an either or, right? And I'm coming back to what I just at the beginning. The consumption attitude of a user is key, right? Because if they consume video on different devices, and if you are able to tell a story across those devices, I think you can easily follow up with different objectives.
Mm-hmm. Well, what I always find is a good indicator on how you grab attention or also convey an emotional message. If you look at the TrueView ad format on YouTube, users that are exposed to a TrueView ad have a choice after 5 seconds to click it away or watch it. So you have 5 seconds in which you can attract the person's attention who's sitting in front of the device, whatever it is. And I've seen lots of examples on advertisers who do this extremely well. Some of you use an element of surprise, others use an emotional element, but it's really about attracting attention at the moment, at the very beginning. And I think something that might be useful, especially if you're thinking about how to set up your creative, we've developed an ABCD framework, which you can also find out more about at our booth by our friends from the Ignition Labs, who give you a little bit on insights on how effective video ads can look like. They say it's first about attracting, then about positioning the brand, then about connecting with the person who's sitting in front of the screen, and that can be an emotional element. And then it's about directing the kind of action that you would like to see. So I think it's one way to think about how creatives can look like and how you can approach this, and by consequence also how you can measure the impact if you have a clear directive call to action at the end, for instance.
And let's touch on another really practical matter for a lot of people. How much does sound matter? How much do you assume that people are going to be playing video with or without sound, and what do you do about that?
Well, it was 85% of video consumptions with sound off. Mm-hmm. And this is another one where I think we're going through a little bit of a change in the industry where, you know, we've kind of flipped between outstream and stream, and it's quite interesting because we've done some research. I don't think we've shared it. Maybe I shouldn't be talking about it. Around comparing them. And again, the important thing is I don't see these things as binary. I think it's how you put them all together. But certainly what we've seen, if you adapt outstream subtitling, for example, the brand engagement goes up. People are actually reading it and paying attention to what's going on. And that's a real eye-opener and again, it goes back to that myopic, you know, thou must have sound on, and thou, you know, these. If you look at it that way, you're way down in the trenches. You need to take a step up and think much more creatively and much more strategically around how these things complement each other. So we found some very interesting results out of Outstream in particular.
Yeah. Anyone else?
Same thing with content, you know. Yeah. If the content videos, especially in the mobile field, you have to write it down. You have to text as well, because the sound is off usually. So we see a huge completion rate if you have additional text on it and without a sound, because the context of usability of mobile video, especially, is commuting or in a public area. You don't have a sound there.
And as we get into the final stretch here, I want to kind of go down the row. And so if we all have the pleasure of reconvening in 2020 for your 21st D-Mexico and come back here, what's one thing you want to see different happen with video advertising? Is that something that you'd love to see improved or added to video advertising over the year ahead? And we'll start with Jim.
I'd like to see more intrigue, actually. I mean, a quote I always talk about from the amazing Bob Levinson, which is, you know, most people ignore advertising because most advertising ignores people. And I think it's true. I think we have to remember that we're talking to humans. This idea that actually at the journal we're doing a lot of work on is kind of, you know, the idea of humble brands, you know, having to earn attention. You know, you have to have a license to talk about yourself in a certain way, and I think if advertisers can get better at that, engagement will be better.
Thanks.
I would really love to see more clients not just putting TV spots into a little frame, to just develop from a creativity point of view, dedicated mobile and online video campaigns. That would be an effort.
Well, we heard today that video ads offer so many opportunities for advertisers, and I would like to see more advertisers taking full possibility of that and leverage it as much as they can. And the other thing that I'd like to see is playing around with some of the new creatives and technology that can be applied to creatives, like augmented reality, for instance, something that we haven't touched upon today, but this is something that will be more popular and also to create more interest on the user side in the future.
I would say less stereotyping in advertising. A lot of the reviews that we do of videos, you know, it's men as bosses and women as housewives, and that's just wrong. We got to get past that within our industry. And I'd also love to get free Netflix. So I'm hoping they have advertising next year.
I think video is an unrevealed format with its proven advantages, right? I think what we will see in the nearer future is really converging the traditional world and the digital world. And I think there it's our responsibility as industry to provide advertisers solutions so that they can target their consumers across all touch points.
Wonderful. Well, I think we're coming up on time, so I want to thank all of you for educating me quite a bit and inspiring me, and hope all of you as well. So,
thank you.
Thank you.